Well, I want to share this with you. Of course, all of you know it's Mother's Day, and we just love moms around here. Mother's Day is a funny time. There's a celebration for most moms, but there's also a heaviness from other moms. You know, a mom that's raising four kids by herself is not an easy job. She probably got up this morning, not one of the little kids said Happy Mother's Day. I don't know who you are, but you're in here raising children by yourself. We love you. We want you to know that God knows who you are, and you are blessed of the Lord, and the hand of God is on you to raise those children, and you're not alone. We're here for you besides God. So we want you to know that. There are moms here that don't feel like they've been good moms and failed in life, but I got to tell you, it's not over with yet. Trust God. God turns things around. There was probably, I don't know for sure, but probably a time when Deborah didn't feel like a good mom at all, but she turned out to be the greatest mom of our kids, a grandmother, and God's done great things. You know, when you get Jesus in your life, it just gets gooder and gooder. But give yourself some time, moms, and stop beating yourself up, and know that we love you and know that God loves you. We have prepared from our video department something special for all the moms. But before we show it, could you just stand to your feet if you're a mom? Listen, just all the moms, just stand to your feet. Now, some of you guys stood to your feet. Sit down, guys. This is just moms. Thank you, thank you, thank you for being moms. You are very, very special. And go ahead and have a seat. Check out the overheads. This is for you.
Dear Mommy, I love you so much. You are the best mommy. You are beautiful. Jesus loves you.
I'm writing you this letter to let you know how much I appreciate and so grateful to God for giving me such a strong and amazing mother. Being as a single mother who worked two jobs to provide care, shelter, clothes, food, and education for us was not an easy task to do. Mom, know that all your hard work, efforts, and sacrifices will never be forgotten.
My dearest Julie, I know that this is out of character for me, but I wanted to take this opportunity to tell you what a wonderful woman you are and how blessed I am to have you for my wife and the girls are to have you for their mother. It's amazing having a best friend, a wonderful love, and a loving mother all wrapped up in one remarkable woman. Everything you are has made me a better man.
I am 13 years old and I feel so very privileged to have a mother like my mom. You are so special. My dad's mom died from cancer when he was just 13, the same age as me. And that makes me thank God even more for you every day. You mean the world to me, Mom.
It has been 25 years since you went home to be with our Lord. You taught me the importance of family and how to always love my children in whatever they may be going through. I am so thankful that you taught me as a young girl about the importance of having a personal relationship with Jesus. This molded and shaped not only my life, but the lives of my children and now my grandchildren.
Happy Mother's Day. I love you so much. I hope you have the best Mother's Day ever. I love you and you are the most beautiful woman in the world.
Our family would not be where we are today, following wholeheartedly after God, if it was not for you. You made countless sacrifices so that we would never be without. Mom, you are always willing to help those in need. You never failed to correct me for my benefit, though at times I hated it, but now I'm thankful beyond measure for what you have done for me to keep me on the right track.
Dear Mom, thank you for always loving us no matter what we did. Thank you for not giving up on us when we weren't going the right direction. Thank you for being there to support us when nothing short of a mother's arms will do.
I know that sometimes we have our moments where we don't get along, but I'm glad we always find our way back. You have come to be someone I can look to for advice and someone I can talk to about certain issues in my life.
Dear Mama, thank you for not going crazy while you were raising me. I remember I used to hide my shoes so I wouldn't have to go to school. Thank you, Mama, for not letting your baby boy grow up as a fool. I love you, Mom. Happy Mother's Day.
And I thank you, Mom, for being just that, my mom.
And it amazes me how you put others' happiness before your own when you are truly the one who deserves it all.
Happy Mother's Day, Mom. I love you always and forever.
Happy Mother's Day.
I have, she's my wife, but the mother of four children and the grandmother of 11 children, 10 grandsons. Man, they tear my house up. But that little girl, she's okay. And but Deborah, you're the mother of the house here, and we have a little gift for you. So I don't know where the gift is, but oh, here comes a gift from the other side of the auditorium, and Big Joe's bringing it in. So this is our way as a church saying thanks for being the mother of the house. Thanks for being a great mother. We love you very, very much. They're not for me, dude. Take them down to her. And of course, at your size, if you want to give them to me, I'll take them. God is so good to all of us. We'll put them in the back room there, because we're going to do this again. I ain't buying her three groups, you know what I'm saying? Happy Mother's Day. Come on, stand to your feet. Let's go to the word of the Lord. I'm going to get down on my knees. I want to welcome all of you that are live streaming right now. You're part of our family. We see you and know that you're there and love you very much. And stay tuned today, because I'll tell you why. It's going to be really an exciting message that's going to change your heart and change your life and give you a purpose and destiny. We're excited about you joining us. Thanks so much for doing that. I'm going to get down on my knees and pray. And let's go before the Lord. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, giving you all the glory, giving you all the honor. Father, we haven't come into the house of God to hear from a man or a woman. We've come into the house of God to hear from the teacher of the church, the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us and motivate us to be all that you would have us to be. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, glory, and all the honor. We thank you for blessing us today, Lord, but we want you to bless all the churches in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet, that are meeting together and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ this day and preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Bless them as you would bless us. And Lord, we'll give you the praise and glory. Bless our Baptist brothers and Lutherans and Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, Pentecostals. Thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, Oak Valley and Oasis and Inland Christian Center. Thank you for the Assemblies of God, Foursquare, Father. We thank you for our Adventist brothers and Catholic brothers and sisters. We thank you, Father, for Trinity, Emmanuel Baptist, Ecclesia Church. At no time, Lord, do we see ourselves as better than them or think of ourselves that way. But we see ourselves as co-laborers, workers together, building one kingdom, and that's yours. And God, we give you all the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we all say, amen. Amen is right. Go ahead, take your seat, get your Bible out with me. Go with me to Hebrews 2nd chapter. As we go to Hebrews, the second chapter, this is really something you're going to have to concentrate on. Is that okay? I'm going to make you think a little bit today. And it's good to come into the house of God, because the word of the Lord is so important for all of us. I've said it 1,000 times. I'll say it 1,000 more times. Listen to me now. This is the manual on how to live life, how to have a great marriage, how to raise your children, how to love your wife or your husband, how to be someone who brings forth prosperity and blessings in every area of your life to your family. This is God's word to you. A lot of times we don't realize to take the seriousness of the word of God and what it says. I remember as a young man being part of a denomination, I won't mention which one, and I was told when I had a hunger to find out what the Bible said that I was not qualified to read the Bible, that I had to have the Bible interpreted through a leader in the church, and it was a sin in that church for me to read the Bible for myself. Later on in life, going my own ways and my own direction, I found myself a derelict and failing in every area of my life. Went back to talk to one of the leaders of that particular type church and found him drunker than I was the night before. And I said, something has to be wrong about all of this. And I started reading my Bible to find out that there were a lot of groups that were meeting where the Bible was being taught and I could learn the Word of God. There I found out some things about not only who Jesus is, but I found out who I was and how to get my life together straight, how to get on the right road that brings me to the right place. And as we look at the Word of God today, I want you to know that the Word of God speaks for itself. What I mean by that, you got to hear this, when you go to church to hear from an old man, you're making a mistake. When you go to church to hear from a young man, you're making a mistake. When you go to church to hear from an educated man, you're making a mistake. When you're going to church to hear from a male or female, or whether it happens to be a black guy or a white guy or an Asian guy or an Hispanic guy, you're making a mistake. We come to church to hear what the Word of God has to say. It'll speak for itself. And oftentimes I look at and marvel at the young generation coming up of young pastors in this church. And I don't look at them as people who are not qualified because they haven't been around very long, because they're not talking about their life. If they were, then it would be a mess. Thank God they're talking about the Word of God, and it doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are. If you talk about the Word of God, it stands for itself and speaks for itself. And you can always get something from God in finding out what the Word has to say, no matter who it is, if your heart's ready to receive from the Lord. And today, God wants to speak to you about something. Before I give you the title of the message, I'm going to review some things with you, and I'm going to talk about some verses. I would like you to do me a favor, do God a favor, and most importantly, do yourself a favor. Listen. Try to adhere. Don't let your minds wander. Try to have comprehension about everything that's being said. Because I found out this is not just for the elite in the church. It's for every person that God wrote the Word of the Lord. Have you ever wondered how a thick book like this on thin paper is just talking about God? It's not. It's talking about you. In the verses we're going at today, 99.99% of the time are taught as if it's just about God, and you can't talk about God without talking about you. And so you need to look at the Word of the Lord and let it speak for itself. Let's read together, if we will, in Hebrews, the 2nd chapter, verse number 9. But we see Jesus, wasn't that a good message? Who was made a little lower than the angels. Stop right there. Why he was made a little lower than the angels is going to be explained in the verse. Look back up at me for a moment. The reason he is made a little lower than the angels is because as he becomes a human cannot transport itself to the other side of the universe instantaneous. A human doesn't live in the spiritual realm and then be seen in the natural realm or from the natural realm to the spiritual realm like angels can do. So all of a sudden, here's the creator of the heavens and the earth, God himself, the Son of God, who now becomes in a position lower than the angels, and that's what he's describing. But for a reason, and I want you to get the reason, because the reason he does what he does has a lot to say about who you are. Oh, watch this, what you're supposed to do. And he says, for the suffering of death. And I love the word suffering there. It means it's not an easy thing. It's going to feel it. You're going to express it. Suffering means the expressions of it is on you. For the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, notice the capital H in the word he, meaning Jesus, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. So here's Jesus Christ going to the cross, being made a little lower than the angels, all man, all God, goes to the cross, nailed to the cross, dies, and then is raised from the dead on the third day, and his blood washes away your sins and my sins. He needed to go to the cross. That's an interesting verse and a powerful verse about Jesus, but it goes on into verse number 10. Are you listening? Because I want to take you there. Watch this in verse number 10. For it was fitting for him. Stop right there. See the words fitting for him? Have you ever heard the expression, if the shoe fits, wear it? In other words, it was fitting for him. He was made for this. This is what it was all about. He knew it. And for those of you that don't understand this, and for years, most people that attend a Christian church don't know this. Sometimes we want to get involved. If we only lived in the days of Jesus, we would stop him from going to the cross. We would resist those Romans. We would fight those Jewish leaders. We would fight for Jesus so he didn't have to suffer on the cross. I want you to know something. You need to understand this, that before the foundation of the world, the plan of redemption by the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost was outlined, and Jesus knew exactly what to do. He was fit for coming. He knew he was going to have to go to the cross. He knew he was going to die. He knew he was going to suffer. That was not a mistake. It was a planned thing from the beginning of time. He was fit for him. For whom are all things, and by whom, speaking of Jesus, are all things. In other words, it's all made by him. It's all for him. Jesus, the creator of the heavens and the earth, realized that he was supposed to go there. He was fit to do this. He was made to do this. Have you ever thought about what you're made to do? Have you ever thought about, with the power of God behind you, what you are fit to do? But let's go on and take a look at this. He says this way, to do something, to bring many sons to glory. In other words, there was a purpose and a reason for Jesus being made a little lower than the angels, going to the cross, and they're experiencing this suffering that he experienced. He was made in such a position, he was fit for that, to do something. And that was to bring, listen to these words, many sons, not a few, to glory. See the word glory up there? Manifested goodness. God wanted to take mankind who had fallen in sin and operating by evil, operating contrary to the ways of God, operating in darkness, and take him out of that darkened position, out of that evil position, and bring him into a place of manifested goodness, the goodness of God displayed. Amen. And when Jesus, the one made lower than the angels, goes to the cross that he was fit to go to, suffers and dies for death for every one of us, does something he says here that is absolutely amazing. He brings many of you and I to the place of the manifested goodness of God. Yeah. Out of the trouble, out of the tribulation, out of the failure, out of the darkness, out of the sin, out of the evil, but into a place of the goodness of God. To make the captain, circle the word in your Bible, captain, of their salvation, perfect through suffering. Someone says, well, wait a minute, Jesus is perfect all along. No, he's made perfect through suffering, what it just said right there. Why? Because there's some things he had never experienced. Number one, he never experienced death. Number two, he never experienced suffering. He was the Son of God, creator of the heavens and earth. And where did he ever suffer? And he never suffered like a human being. And there was a purpose for all of that. He'd never been a human being before. So all of a sudden, he had never done that. Now, through this suffering, he is going to be made complete to do something, to bring many sons and daughters out of the darkness into the goodness of God, which waits for every single one of us. But the word captain, I had you circle. The word captain is a bizarre word, and it really refers to you. Really refers to me. The word captain there means this, chief leader. Let me say it again. I know some of you heard it, some of you didn't, but let me say it again. He is the chief leader of their salvation. Amen. Someone says, what do you mean, chief leader? He is the number one leader for all of us that are born of the Spirit of God. If he's the leader, the question is, are we following him? Amen. Didn't ask you whether you're blood washed. Didn't ask you whether your sins are forgiven. Didn't ask you if you're part. I'm asking you, if he's the chief leader, he must be leading us somewhere. The Bible also interprets that word captain as if he's out ahead of the group saying, come on, I've already gone this way. I've already passed by. I've already done this. I've already resurrected from the dead. Now just follow me and you will too. Yes, and all of a sudden now he becomes the chief leader, which brings a question. If he's the leader, who are we following? If he's the leader, how do we live our life? If he's the chief leader that laid his life down, are you saying that we should lay our life down? Now, no one's telling you to go to the cross. Jesus has already done that. But there is a position that we take that activates the very power of God. Hear me now. That brings in the blessings of the Lord into your life. And that position is the same position that Jesus took when he went to the cross and died, that brought many into the goodness of God. Let me explain it like this, by the title of our message, the law of sacrificial substitution goes into effect. Did you know that we live our lives by a lot of laws? When an apple falls from a tree, a law goes into force. It does not float around. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? It does what? It hits the ground. Why does it hit the ground? Because of the law of gravity. When an airplane takes off and the wind and the speed of that wind and air goes above its wings and below its wings, it has a law that takes place. It's called the law of lift. We live by that. The law of heat and sun and energy. There's all kinds of laws that we literally live our life by, but there's a spiritual law that takes place that we see in verse number 9 and verse number 10 that takes place with Jesus. That spiritual law is a life of sacrifice that takes the place of someone else so that someone else could walk in a blessed way. Let's define the word blessed. Blessed means this: the power to succeed. You had no power to succeed before in your life. You were on the bondage of Satan. You were a captive person. Jesus, who's made a little lower than the angels, goes to the cross. It's fitting for him, and he dies. He does something. He suffers and dies and sacrifices for you. Sacrifice means he gives up something for someone else. And he gets into a place of substitution where he takes on who you are, your sins. And he cries out to the Father, "Father, it's finished." He knew exactly what he had done. In other words, he was in that place of giving up himself for the betterment of someone else. Let me say it again. He was in that place of giving up himself for the betterment of someone else. Now, if he is the captain, chief leader of our life, then he becomes our example and how to live life. I am not telling you to go to the cross, but I am telling you that you must live your life not just for yourself, but for the betterment of others. And when you do, the law, which brings the blessings, goes into effect. Amen. When you don't, it's a selfish, boring, religious life all about you. Yeah. At the end of your life, you wonder what in the world have you done? Why is it God hasn't answered your prayers? Why are you not blessed? When God wanted to bless you, all we need to do, all of us, is follow the chief leader. Well, how do I follow the chief leader? See, for most people, if you're never taught, you think following the chief leader is just being a good guy or a nice guy, because that's all you're ever taught. That Jesus is just this good guy. He's just this nice guy. We've never been really taught any more than that. You don't have to be taught any more than that. Just come to the church. Let somebody sprinkle water all over you and blow smoke on you. And let somebody say some words that mean absolutely nothing. And then go out and guess what? Give us your money before you leave. Do you know what I'm talking about? That's called religion. And let me keep you brain dead about what your responsibilities really are. You know why? So I want to control you. And the more people I control as an organization, the more power I have to make decisions on things. Instead of us getting into the Word of God and finding out what God is saying here, He is our chief leader. Wow, wait a minute. You mean to tell me that as Jesus was sacrificial and became the substitute of people and is our example and is our leader, that that's what you're asking me to look at as my own life? Mm-hmm. But what if I told you when you put something in with God, there's another law goes into effect, you get something greater out. But I don't want to give up. I want to be blessed. In order to be blessed, you've got to give up. What you sow, you reap. If you sow nothing, you reap nothing. Is anybody listening? So laws go into effect. Let me prove it to you. Paul writes under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, church at Ephesus. Now, Paul's a writer of 2/3 of the New Testament, probably the greatest human being that ever walked on the planet since the death of Jesus. An amazing human being, quite an example for all of us. You know him, Paul the Apostle. He writes these words in Ephesians, the 5th chapter, verse number 1. May I read it to you? I'll put it up on the overhead. Verse number 1 says these words. It says, therefore be imitators of God as dear children. So all of a sudden he's telling us to imitate God. We don't know how to imitate God because we don't know what God's done. We think God's a good guy, nice guy. We think he's, you know, he came for us. We should be good people. We should be nice people. That's not what he's talking about. Be imitators of God. It means what God did, you do. Why? Because he's the chief, what? Leader. Or is anybody following? And so that's what the difference is. That's a cool verse, but it's not as cool as the second verse. Are you ready? Watch this. Second verse says it like this. And walk in love. What's love? Personal self-sacrifice. The giving of oneself for the betterment of someone else. Let me define it again for you. What's love? Personal self-sacrifice, the giving of yourself for the betterment of someone else. What are we talking about? We're talking about sacrificial substitution. What's love? Love is personal self-sacrifice, the giving of yourself for the betterment of someone else. Even if they don't appreciate it? Uh-huh. Even if they don't recognize it? Yep. Even if it, you know, it draws from you, absolutely takes from you. Why? Because that's what Jesus did. Now, the proof of that is as you keep reading the verse, walk in love. The word walk means to live out life. Live out life in love as Christ also loved us. How did he love us? And he gave himself for us. How? An offering and a sacrifice to God. What you do for someone else, you do for God. And when you do it for God, all of a sudden, it becomes a sweet smelling aroma. So he becomes now our chief, what, leader, like it says. And we start being a people, instead of just thinking about this, as a church, we start being a people who care about others more than we care about ourselves. But as we care for others, God cares for us. And as we give to others, God gives to us. And I don't know about you, I'd much rather have what God has than what I have. Yeah. So if I give to others what I have, then guess what happens? Here's the principle. God gives me what he has. Oh, it gets gooder and gooder. The law, it just goes into effect. I'm going to read some verses to you that don't make a lot of sense, but they will now that you understand this. Jesus communicated this all the time to his disciples and people around him. You know, I was one time taught, well, God said that to his disciples. Jesus said it to his disciples. It's really not for us. Can I tell you something? If it's not for us, then God's just interested in a history lesson. Why did he preserve the word of God for thousands of years? This is not a history lesson, like whoever gets to heaven and becomes the greatest historian gets the biggest crown. That's not the way it works. Here's how it works. It works this way, because you and I realize that God's not just talking to his disciples or the people following him, but he's preserved the word of God so that he could talk to you and I today about how to be and what to be. If he's going to be the chief leader, I need to know how to be one of the chief followers. Imitators of God. Watch this. Go with me to Matthew. Turn in your Bible to Matthew, and let's just read a few verses in the 19th chapter of Matthew. Let's take a look at it together. Matthew, the 19th chapter. If you've got your Bible, you should always have your Bible when you come to the Rock. Man, we emphasize the word of the Lord. You don't have a Bible, we'll either give you a Bible, it's a cheap one, or you can go buy a good one at the bookstore. Matthew, the 19th chapter, starting in verse number 29. Jesus is speaking, listen to the word he says, and he says now to start to outline the law of sacrificial substitution. Is anybody listening? In verse number 29, and everyone who has left houses, brothers, sisters, or fathers, or mothers, or wives, or children, or land. Wait a minute, I don't like that. My flesh wants it read like this. Everybody that gets houses and brothers and sisters, everybody that has lots of fathers and mothers and, oh, a bunch of wives, children and a bunch of real estate. But that's not what he's talking about. For my sake shall receive a hundredfold inheritance of eternal life. Verse 30 comes along and says, but many who are first will be last. In other words, the people that got it, that don't understand how the principle of the law works, will end up without. But the people who give it up and realize that God is their source become first. And the last should be first. So the positioning of yourself and of myself is very important. Now, I want you to catch this because it's so important that the law is described, but sometimes we don't quite understand it. Let's go and take a look at Mark, the 8th chapter, starting in verse number 34. When he had called the people to himself with his disciples. So this is not just, this is a people, this is generally. And he says to them, whoever desires, I love the word whoever. Didn't say the priest, didn't say the pastor, didn't say the song leader, didn't say the leader of the church, didn't say the evangelist, didn't say the apostle, didn't say anybody, didn't say the prophet. He says, whoever, whoever means you and me. We're the whoever's of the Bible. And he says, whoever. Whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. You'll never follow Jesus to be like Jesus is on this planet as long as you're first and others are second. Then it comes along, it says, for whoever, I love the word whoever again, verse 35. Who saves his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. But the next couple of verses are the great verses that I love. What will it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Verse 37, or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? I was watching television this other day. It's rich, very rich. Powerful Hollywood mogul, had everything you can possibly think of, all the toys he had, houses in different places. He had a swimming pool that every morning got out of bed, got in a swimming pool, took a lap. Now, it wasn't the pool for the house. It was the pool in his bedroom. So that when he got out of bed, he got in his lap pool and did his laps. Kept him from having to go outside. He made this comment, this Hollywood mogul with all the wealth. He said this, I'm trying to find a religion that'll allow me to take all the stuff I have with me when I go. And I yelled back at the television, sucker, you're gonna need the swimming pool where you're going. You were born naked on this planet, and you might as well understand you're not taking anything with you. If you've got false teeth in your mouth, most likely they won't go. And you might as well serve God from the time you first cry to the last breath with all of your life in a sacrificial substitution state where you give of yourself for the betterment of someone else, which brings the blessings to you, so that the world could see that the goodness of God changes the lives of people. Amen. And that's what Jesus said. Jesus is walking on the road with his disciples. They're fighting among themselves. Jesus asked them, what are you fighting about? They're silent and don't want to tell Jesus. I mean, you talk about dumb. Don't you know that God knows what you're thinking and talking about all the time? If he asks the question, he's only asking to see whether or not you're going to get honest. The question was, who's going to be the greatest? Let me get out of the Greek and let me get out of the Hebrew and let me get into San Bernardino. One was saying, dude, walking along, I'm going to be the greatest. I'm the coolest. I'm it, man. You're not going to make it. Or you're going to be on his left side, but I'm going to be on his right side. And you're not even, you and your mama are going to be way in back. That's San Bernardino language, a translation. And I want you to hear what I'm saying to you right now. These disciples don't realize that Jesus has already figured out what they said. And then he comes back with an expression that is just monumental about the law of sacrificial substitution. Watch it. Go with me, if you will. Ninth chapter of Mark. In ninth chapter of Mark, starting verse number 35, and when he came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, what was you disputing about among yourselves on the road? But they kept silent, verse number 34. For on the road they had disputed among themselves, and who would be the greatest? After not hearing from them, listen to this, he sits down, verse number 35, and calls the 12 and said to them, if anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all. If anyone desires to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all. In other words, you've got to make yourself under everybody else. That's what Jesus did on that cross at Calvary. Paul writes about his stuff. You see, there's a price to pay for sacrificial substitution. It cost Jesus everything, and it will cost you everything. It'll cost you you. It'll cost you your stuff. It'll cost you your feelings. It'll cost you your emotions and ego. It'll cost you something. It'll cost you you. There's a price to be paid. So Paul writes about what he lost, and he describes the stuff that he lost. I thought it was fascinating. May I read it to you? Listen to what Paul writes, if you will, in Philippians, the third chapter, verse number 7. Just pop it up on the overhead for us and take a look at verse number 7. It says, but what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for Christ. In other words, the stuff I used to have, they're not important to me anymore. Verse number 8 comes along. Listen to this. He says, and yet indeed, I also count all things lost for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them to be rubbish. See the word rubbish up there? Yeah. The word rubbish, some of your Bibles has the word dung, D-U-N-G. The word dung translated in San Bernardino language is poo-poo. Biodegradable product. Poop. He says the stuff that I have lost for the Christ, I count as poop compared to the things that I my gain of Christ. Verse number 9 comes along and he makes this statement, pop it up, verse 9. And he found in him not having his own righteousness, which was from the law. The word law there is not talking about the laws that we're talking about. It's talking about the law of Moses, talking about the law of the flesh. But that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith. But verse 10 says it all. Watch this. That I may know him. Now, he's our leader. He's our chief leader. How do I know how to follow if I don't know who he is? What position do I get in? Do I just act like a good person? Am I just here to be a nice person? Am I here just to fit into society? Am I here just to fit into political situations, you know, and not give anybody any trouble? Here's what Paul says. He says that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. and the fellowship of his suffering. In other words, when you give yourself for someone else, you will feel it. Being conformed to his death, which, by the way, brought life. Because what you sow, you reap. In fact, John puts it like this, words of Jesus, pop it up in book of John, the 12th chapter, last verse for today. It says, most assuredly I say unto you, unless grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. In other words, we need to get out of ourselves and get into him, to the place that he is into others. And then God blesses you in what you do. Is anybody listening? Now let me give you an illustration of that. A man every day gets out of bed, puts on his pants, and goes to work. Doesn't want to do it. Probably wants to stay in bed. Love to hang out with the kids. But he goes to work every day. And he gives of himself at that job, bringing money in to feed the family. When that doesn't happen, it's out of order. A mom gets out of bed in the middle of the night, sacrificing her sleep, sacrificing her time in a place of suffering because she hasn't had a lot of sleep. Baby's crying, pooped its pants, need to be fed, need to be changed, need to be held, need to be cuddled. But back to bed, guess what? That is an example of sacrificial substitution. We see that as common. We see that as normal. But can you imagine what it would be like if we took those normal, common situations that we see and experience every day of our life, and the church takes it on for not just family, but for others? Why, we'd turn the world upside down, or should be right side up, for Jesus. Today, sacrificial substitution is what Jesus did, and that is really the way you and I are to live our life. Or the alternative, go back to the incense and sprinklings and ecclesiastical robes and be controlled spiritually by someone who just wants to control you instead of going forward in the things of Christ. Now, whether you go to this church, there's many great churches out there. I'm not saying we're the only church in town, but make sure you get into a church that's going to teach you the word of God so you can take it, apply it, put it into your life, use it day in and day out. As sacrificial substitution, people that are imitating Christ and him crucified every day. And watch the blessings of the Lord come into your life. The power to succeed comes by what you plant. For what you sow, you shall reap. If God spoke to you today, come on, give the Lord a great big praise. Woo, my, that is good stuff. Listen, I just want to make sure before you all leave, listen closely to what I'm going to say to you. I'm going to say this just in a moment. I want to give some of you an opportunity. Let me just say it like this. You're going to die, and you're going to go to hell. I know that's hard after laughing, but this is still the truth. You're going to die, and you're going to go to hell. And you don't want that to happen. You want to be saved, and you want to go to heaven. And Jesus tells us in Scripture exactly how to do that. He says, you must be born again. He says these words also, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. You can't get there your way. You can't get there my way. Hey, we can't get there some well-meaning church committee's way. We're going to have to get to heaven God's way. And Jesus tells us exactly how to get there in John 3rd chapter. Listen to me now. Listen. He says, you must be born again. Now, let me define for you what the scripture says from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, what born again really means. It means that you have given God all of your heart. It means you've given God all of your life. It is an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. I already know you know who he is or you wouldn't be here. I already know you celebrate Easter and Christmas or every year of your life. I already know you have head knowledge about who he is, but it's not about what you've done with your head. Listen to me now. In order to get to heaven, it's about what you've done with your heart. And you got to give Jesus all of your heart. You got to give him all of your life. He won't steal it from you. He's not a thief. He's not a conniver to talk you out of it and a manipulator to make you do it. You got to want this by giving him what he gave you, all of his heart, and what he gave you all of his life. And today, here we are in this safe place. You were great listening to the word of God. Great. Worshiping and praising. It's been a great day of just having a great time. We've laughed, sung together, heard the word. God spoke to you. But for some of you that are in here, unless you get really right with God, you're not going to make it. And I'm telling you right now, there's at least 25 of you that are going to go to hell. God's telling me that right now in the spirit. If he can tell me what to say to you, he can tell me how many people need to get saved in here right now. Now, I don't know if any of you will respond. That's your business. I can't make you do this. In fact, to tell you the truth, I don't want to make you do it. If I make you do it, it's religion. If you do it yourself, it's because you want it from with God. And that's what this is all about. In a moment, we're all going to stand. As we stand, those of you that need to give God all of your heart and all of your life, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible friend, even from the family room. If your kids are saying, I want to go, give my heart to Jesus. Debbie was under 7 years old when she walked up to the bus. She remembers that day like it was yesterday in that church, that same place. We visited that place. Don't stop your children. You bring them, parents. And I want every single one of you, I want anybody to leave this auditorium, whether the 25 respond or don't respond, I don't know. But I'm going to let you know that you need to get out of your seat, get your stuff, and come up here, and we'll pray with you to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. Because you know you haven't yet given God all of your heart. You've been lukewarm, little in, little out, little up, little down. You've been a good person, but you've never given him all of your heart and life. Because you can't get to heaven by just being a good person. You get to heaven because you gave God your heart and gave God your life. Hey. It's now your call. I threw the ball back in your park. You're going to play with it or are you going to throw it to the ground? It's your choice. Let's all stand. Nobody clap. One at a time, you get your stuff. If you know you need to get right with God, get out of your seat. And meet me right here in front. You come right now. Come on. Come on, let's get right with God.
It's your mercy.
Come on.
That draws me near.
Come on.
By grace I'm standing.
Oh, they're coming. Come on. Hurry up. Don't clap. Come on. Come on, you back there. Don't let anything disturb you. Get out of your seat. You know you need to come.
My wrong.
You need to get right with God. This is your time. You need to get born again, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. Get out of your seat. Get up here right now. Come on.
By grace I'm standing here. No matter the road I've walked, it's covered my
heart. You know you need to come. You're just saying to yourself, I wonder if I should. You know, the Bible says, first kind of person that won't go to heaven is a coward. First one, before murderers, before adulterers, a coward. Revelation, book of Revelation, says, I'm afraid. Are you afraid of people? you just come right now. I'm going to give you just a moment more, and that's it. Out of the family rooms, you come right now. And you're going to miss this. People are still coming. Hurry, because you don't want to miss this. The last service, this little girl, she's the cutest thing you ever saw, in the family room, dragged her mother out and ran to the front. I laughed. I said, that's the way adults ought to be, like children, like that. You need to come right now. They're still coming. You come on. It's your time to get right with God. They're still coming. Hurry. Hurry. You know it's you. You know it's you. Stop messing with God. You know it's you. You know if you die, you don't even know if you're going to make it. You ought to make sure. Get out of your seat and come. Because if you don't give yourself, you're never going to receive. Come on. I'm going to give you a moment more, and then we're going to stop. We're going to stop, and you're going to miss it. I hope you come back. Hope you live long enough to come back. What would you give for your soul? The verse said. All of you in front, thank God there's probably 25 of you here. But listen, this is Pastor Dave. He's waving at you. He's going to pray with you in just a few moments to invite Jesus into your heart and give you some free stuff. He's going to tell you about our SPT, Spiritual Personal Trainer program, that'll help you. You said you're going to give God all of your heart and your life. Take a moment. People you came with, they'll wait for you. Follow Pastor Dave right over this way. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. We do that?